I talked about the deadweight loss concept a few days ago, which is where the idea of fiscal conservatism comes from, because this concept explains why taxes can shrink the size of the economy. But anyone who's patient enough to sit through the first few weeks of any econ class will know that this model is very limited. You can't use this graph as a scripture or something. Unlike religions, any model requires assumptions. For example, this model requires that a product only affects the producer and the consumer of that product. So when a product affects a third party, the conclusion will be totally different. And you can no longer argue that taxes are inherently bad. If you're interested in the mathematical explanation, wait until the end of the video, but I'll first try to explain it without math. So let's say for a normal product, the market equilibrium gives us the optimal price and the optimal quantity. You know, the invisible hands. You heard about it? Totally cool, right? But what if there's a pollution that results from that product? Maybe the pollution will hurt the buyers and the sellers of that product, but most of the pollution goes to third parties who have no say in the transaction. So when the producers and the consumers make their decisions, when they draw their supply and demand curves, they won't take that pollution into account, right? When you buy a car, you're not gonna think, how much smog I'm gonna produce. Of course, you're also a victim of the smog in general, but this specific car that you're buying only contributes to a tiny share of the smog you inhale personally. So you don't care. And such effects of a product on third parties are called externalities. Since the buyers and the sellers' decisions fail to take into account pollution, when we're at the market equilibrium, the products that create pollution will be oversupplied. So by oversupplied, I mean they will be produced at a level higher than the socially optimal level. There will be so many cars that the marginal benefit provided by each car to society will be outweighed by the marginal cost in the form of pollution created by that car. So how to make car production stay at the optimal level, neither too many for people to breathe nor too few for people to get around? Well, the government can collect a tax from car owners. This way, cars will still exist in the market, but the quantity is slightly reduced because the after-tax price is now higher. And the government also has some revenue to manage pollution. So if the tax rate is at the right level, you will be able to achieve an optimal quantity of cars in the market. So in general, any harm done to third parties by a product is called a negative externality. And in a totally free market, products with negative externalities will be oversupplied. So a tax is needed to bring the quantity down to the optimal level. But there are also products with positive externalities. Say you hire someone to fix your front yard, or backyard not so much, but the front yard, well, if it looks good, it makes the passerbys feel good for free. A lot of examples like that. But the most prominent example I want to talk about is education. Oh my God, the positive externality of education is enormous. Why? We're social animals. When we learn something, we can't help sharing it, right? And we can't help using our knowledge to help people around us, sometimes not even realizing it. Just try to recall in the past 24 hours how many times you have shared your knowledge with another human being without getting paid. I bet a lot. It means when you pay for education, you are not the only person who benefits. I'm not just talking about daily conversations. Let's say you invent a product. Maybe you can apply for a patent to prevent knockoffs. But it's never 100% copy-proof. People can always steal some ideas off of it, like Windows and Mac OS, iPhone and Android. You see what I mean. all inventions will create some sort of knockoffs. That's a good thing, right? But when people purchase education or research, they don't do it for the third parties. So under a pure market equilibrium, education will be undersupplied by a lot. There won't be enough free knowledge to go around. That's why in modern days, you go to any country in the world, there's always public education. The positive externality of education is just too large to forgo. No country can afford to let the market determine the quantity of knowledge. They have to throw money at education. So a basic rule of thumb is that whenever a product creates benefits not intended by buyers and sellers, the government needs to step in and subsidize that product. Otherwise, it will be undersupplied. You can think of it as a way for free riders to pay their share, right? You can't charge people directly for using your knowledge, but the government can collect a tax from everyone and give that money to you in the form of free education. So a subsidy on a positive externality is essentially a way to channel money from free riders to paying customers. So negative externalities, tax them, and positive externalities, subsidize them. Simple. So when you hear someone say, we want to deregulate pollution and we want to get rid of school lunches because we have this invisible hand of the market, well, just remind them to go to chapter 2 of whatever econ book they're citing, because apparently they stopped at chapter 1. Now I'll give you a more formal explanation about externalities using supply and demand curves. If you're too tired for math today, you can keep scrolling, but knowing the model will reinforce your understanding of the topic. If you don't remember what this graph means, please watch my video posted on August 11th. So supply curve represents the lowest prices each producer can accept, and the demand curve represents the highest prices each consumer can accept. So the horizontal line represents the actual market price. So the green and yellow triangles are the total benefit this product brings to the consumers and the suppliers, which was all explained in that video. Now, what if this product creates some additional benefit to other members of the society, like schools that spread knowledge, or trees that create oxygen, or maybe bridges that people can cross for free? So basically anything that creates externalities. Sometimes we also call them non-excludable goods because you can't exclude non-paying people from enjoying them. So because of the externality, the total benefit of this product is not just the consumer and producer surpluses, but also includes this parallelogram representing externalities. So why is it a parallelogram? Well, each unit of the product produces this much of externality. Then of course, when you add up all the units, it will be this entire area. So the entire contribution of this product to society is this whole blue, green, and yellow trapezoid. But what if I tell you this is not the optimal amount of benefits we can get? Let's say the government offers a subsidy to everyone who buys this product. Let's say if you buy a tree and you create $10 worth of oxygen to society. So the government rewards $10 to everyone who buys a tree. Now what will happen? The demand curve will move up because with the subsidy, people can now afford a higher price. Let's say I used to think a tree is worth $100, but because I will get $10 of subsidy, I now think I can afford buying the tree for $110. Now, because of this new demand curve, there's now a new intersection with the supply curve. So the equilibrium quantity will also be larger. That means the total consumer and producer surplus is no longer the green and yellow triangle, but this whole big triangle that ends at the new intersection. This big triangle. So what's the new externality? It will also be bigger. It will be this longer parallelogram that also extends to the new intersection. So we now have a bigger trapezoid to cover all the benefits created by this product, the externality and the consumer and producer surplus. But be careful, this is not the net benefit. Because remember, in order to get to this new equilibrium, the government has to pay a subsidy, which is a cost to the taxpayers. So it's a negative benefit. So we need to deduct the subsidy from this total benefit. Now, how much is the subsidy? Well, also the red part, because that's the right amount of subsidy to bring the demand curve up to the level we want, right? $10 of externality, then $10 of subsidy. So the total amount of subsidy equals the total amount of externality. That means this red part is just canceled off. That means the new net benefit is just this big triangle. Gray, blue, green, and yellow, this big triangle. And guess what? This triangle is larger than the original trapezoid without the subsidies. Now, as you can see, by adding the subsidies and driving up the demand curve up, the total benefit of the product is enlarged by this little gray triangle. It doesn't look much, but that's just because the size of the triangle depends on the size of externality. If the externality is really big, which means there's a big difference between these two demand curves, then the gray triangle can also be really, really big. Sometimes when the externality is too big, maybe the government should just take over the entire production, say a bridge in a public area. If someone pays to build the bridge, then everyone else will just free ride. So the externality is much bigger compared to the consumer surplus, compared to the benefit to that person. In that case, maybe the market just shouldn't even bother, and the government should just build the bridge entirely with taxpayers' money. That's why a lot of public facilities like roads and bridges and parks and streetlights are almost entirely built by the government. Okay, so that was just one of many examples of why the free market alone doesn't always work. Let's keep going next time.